The earliest dictionaries, the Dutch dictionaries and the English dictionaries, those are the two that I'm most familiar with. The term Moor or Moorens or Moores is used to refer to what we would say are so-called black people. What is more accurately, African people. Particularly African people of a darker olive complexion, but it can vary. In fact, when Leo Africanus, who was a Moor taken captive and then converted to Catholicism, and then wrote a book about the history of the Moors, and he basically says the proper name for what people were calling Ethiopes or Ethiopians or so-called Negroes was Moor. That's why the word Moor is so pervasive in so many languages. French, it's Moor. As I already said, Germanic languages, it's Moor, M-O-H-R. And in part, people say it's because of the association with the Roman, the Latin Mores. But then the Greek preceded it, the Mavros, or Moros. But as I said already, its origins are most certainly in Africa. So it was an indigenous term. The reason why the transition occurs is because as the Moors lose power, those European forces that are taking over see the need to start to denigrate, and I use that word intentionally, and devalue the African person, the African woman and man in history, in order to justify the new conditions. The new conditions are now Europe is in ascension. Plus, I dare say, it also has to do with what then emerges with something known as the law of nations. Because theories around nationality and what that means and the law of nations and then treaties comes into play. So you have people of European Christian ancestry saying, we have to emphasize now our greatness by devaluing the African. That's a part of it. And not all, but I would venture to say most who are in positions of power start to adopt that view. Then the second thing that they do is they understand that since we're talking about nations and the law, if we recognize you as a nation, under the sacred treaties, in fact, Emmerich de Vattel, who was recognized as having talked about the law of nations and the sacredness of treaties, said nations should respect other nations. But if you create a situation where folks are under the law, made into non-persons, then what you're doing is creating a condition for their legal oppression. Now, it ain't right, don't get me wrong. It ain't right. I'm not just because people will try to say, well, but so you're saying the legal, I'm not saying that that doing that is justified because it's still immoral. You're still oppressing and abusing a people. But what I'm explaining is how the law worked within that context. And to some extent, it even worked in African or Asian or Native American communities as well that had a similar attitude. If you're part of our nation, then we recognize the need to protect and defend you because you're part of our nation. If you're not, then you should try to either get, what we say, naturalized into it because other nations have naturalized systems of naturalization, or you remain an outsider. So under the law, personhood was expunged to justify the asiento from a a group of nations that call themselves Christians and respecters of the law of nations and the sacredness of treaties. So when you look at, like you said, something like the Bible, the earliest Bibles referencing Moor or Moorans, and then eventually coming down the Ethiopians or just black, it's because the Bible is reflecting the new reality, or I would say new confusion, of the people of that era. It's why the average quote-unquote black person on the, people say on the street, if you ask the average sister or brother why they're not black or why you don't, or why they shouldn't call themselves black, they would be lost unless they were willing to sit down and listen for a while to the rationale for where this comes from. Like I said, understanding systems of oppression is key to being able to resist oppression. If you don't understand what the motivation was for putting that into place in the first place, you don't know how to deal with it. Orlando Patterson, who wrote, who's a sociologist also at Harvard, who talked about slavery and social death. And he actually, I met the brother at a conference in Germany, and I had just recently read one of his quotes where he said he actually got to a point where he refused to call quote unquote whites whites. He was calling them Euro-American. And he was referring to us, if you will, as Afro-American. And I asked him what happened. He said, I tried that for a while. I tried to get people to do it. He said, and man, the pushback was so great, he said, I just gave up. But the reason he did it was because he understood that the terms black and white were basically serving the agenda, if you will, of Eurocentric hegemony or so-called white supremacy. So he was essentially saying, you know, I recognize that was problematic and I tried to get people to stop using the term. I gave up. Right, because it's reinforced so much that Dr. Akbar also coins a phrase, pathological normalcy, right? And I think that this applies. This pathological normalcy, we see pathological behavior as normal because it's done by the majority. It's normative, so it becomes the standard. But so much of what's needed is a mental paradigm shift so that folks can really understand what's going on.